and regulatory consultant at Medical Devices International, Sialkot, Pakistan. He'll be talking about the orthopedic implants industry in Pakistan, current challenges and future opportunities. Mr. Shaukat Ali has been a long-time supporter and is always a participant of all our events, and we look forward to working with him towards tackling the regulatory challenges that some of the R&D is facing. So ladies and gentlemen, please give a round of applause to Mr. Shaukat Ali.
Assalamu alaikum. Because this symposium is particularly on the orthopedic implant related, and I'm also representing the industry side and working in the industry and seeing what are the challenges they are having practically. So I will put more light onto the orthopedic implant industry in Pakistan and the current challenges and what are the future opportunities for the manufacturers of orthopedic implants and what is ahead for the orthopedic surgeons. The success, if we see the successful model of the orthopedic surgery, we see that the surgeons and manufacturers contribute their skills and technology for the successful surgeries and for the better life of the patients, which is the win-win situation for patients, doctors and the manufacturers, because the successful surgery improves the quality of life of the patients, gives the success to the surgeons and gives the profit to the organization who is manufacturing the instruments. Worldwide, substandard artificial implants are causing disabilities and deaths, because this is very much common if the things go wrong, and unfortunately in Pakistan it is not being documented. And a large number of stunts, orthopedic implants, catheters, contraceptive devices are reported to cause serious health issues. I am not giving here the figures because the figures were a little bit terrifying. But I have given the link. This study has been published recently on 27th of November, just 3 days before, in the online newspaper, and it has been also highlighted on the television. And about the implants in Pakistan and other such issues, this study indicates that a clinical governance is only observed in Aga Khan Karachi and Shaukat Khan Lahore. Most probably doctors from Doctor Hospital can tell that probably there might be also clinical governance, because after the incidents of the arm broken and closure of the hospital, there was a lot working on the clinical governance, so that if there is something goes wrong with the patients, it should be reported somewhere else, it should be clinically investigated, and it should be thoroughly thoroughly recorded so that the future incidents can be prevented. The most important thing is the safety and performance of the medical devices. If you see the definition of the medical devices, it is very wide, that anything which helps to treat the disease or helps to alleviate the symptoms of the disease. This is the one part of the definition which covers the medical devices. So in this way, our useful implants are the medical devices which are used for the long-term times for the patient. Sometimes patients are being put the orthopedic hip prosthesis, which is usually in many cases is inserted inside the body after the age of 50 years, and it remains till the death of the patient, till the life of the patient. So it is inside the body for 15 to 20 years. So the safety is more important, that how much behavior of the metal or the ceramic or the other material is inside the body. So the safety is important. If we see the cycle of the medical device manufacturing, whether it is the orthopedic implant or anything else, it is the same. First of all, like the researchers here are having the concepts, concept and product planning. Then they plan the resources. Here we call the financiers and the investors. Then there is a stage of deployment of those resources and development of the product, development of the system, and product is realized. Then comes the quality assurance, whether what we have produced is as per our requirements, whether it is meeting the quality standards, whether it is meeting the requirement of the patient, whether it is meeting whatever we wanted, whatever we have planned, it is exactly like that. Then we conduct the risk assessment and prepare the documentation. Risk assessment as per the international standards, risk assessment as per the nature of the device, risk assessment as per nature of the procedure which is going to be performed. And then after the risk assessment, we see what the improvements are needed and what we have to do more to make the product more safe. and then we pass through the regulatory compliance and go for the marketing. And the last stage comes the profitability. So we have to follow the whole cycle for development of the medical devices, and it's it's anything else which is related to medical industry, the cycle is the same. There are certain other phases. This is the summary of the cycle. If we see the sources of the implants, there are two sources. One is the local industry and one is the imported. In the local industry, we have the advantage that prices are very low, easily available. The orthopedic implants available in the variety, and customization is possible to some extent. Some of the surgeons need some for the specific patient special size or some specific angle of the implant that is available. The constraint is the quality is low. And if you see the imported implants, they are high in quality. All these advantages which we are having from the local industry are disadvantages for the imported ones. They are expensive, they are not easily available, that much variety is not available, and customization is not possible for the imported implants. And the constraint is the high price. Every patient is not such affording, because our health sector model in Pakistan is not that much social, that every patient is being treated from the government, but patient has to bear all the expenses for the health requirements. And now I put light on to the required standard, which are required for the orthopedic implants specifically. These are the standards, all standards, which you will have to fulfill before getting the product into the market. One is the ISO 9000, which is a quality management system of the organization. It's a generic in nature. This standard is applicable to every kind of organization, whether it's a school, it's a university, it's a institution, or it's a factory. But this specific standard, without this, you cannot manufacture even a simple needle, even simple bandages, anything else to the health related, because this standard is specifically medical device quality management system. This describes the boundaries, this describes the role of the organization, the responsibilities of the organization, the traceability of the medical device to be manufactured, so that if something goes wrong, afterwards, after the implantation, then we can trace out the root cause of the thing and we can improve the things. And we can see what went wrong, who manufactured, who was responsible for the different process in that production process. One important standard, this is what is lacking and what is required, particularly to the new search, which we have been discussing since morning, is the ISO 14155. This is a clinical investigation of medical device for human beings. Because once you develop, have a concept, you develop a medical device, you need to test it in animals, then you need to test in the human beings. Without the human trials, you cannot market any product in the world. And in the morning, there was discussion that there are different processes in the different parts of the world. In the FDA, the process for a new or novel device, novel medical instruments or the device is called the PMA, pre-market approval, that takes not less than 3 years, and upward is not the limit. So if you develop a product which has been tested in the animals, which has passed all the quality standards, even then you cannot go into the market because it's such a long process. And the important thing is safety in the human beings. So PMA is important, and then you can market the product. Similarly, in Europe, you have to go through the medical device directive requirements, and you have to comply all these standards. So this standard is important. Even the good luck is for Pakistan is that this standard is applicable in Pakistan, and the regulator in Pakistan has set a mechanism for registering your clinical study, for which you can go through and then you can launch your product. And there is another standard for the, because we are talking of the implants, it is ISO 14630. It's a non-active surgical implant. The general requirements, what requirements we should meet whenever we are manufacturing or developing a surgical implant or orthopedic implant. And this is the specific standard, ISO 5832. Implant for surgery, medical material part 1 for wrought steel. Whenever we are developing the stainless steel orthopedic implants, we have to comply with this standard. And whenever we are manufacturing the titanium alloy, which is titanium, aluminium and vanadium alloy, then we have to follow 5832. These standards are mandatory whenever we are developing the orthopedic implants. Similarly, the biological evaluation, this is what I was discussing with Dr. Hassan. ISO 10993 basically makes and gives a guideline of all the requirements which are required to meet the biocompatibility standards. And this standard is basically, it has 18 parts. First one describes the basic requirements and how you will evaluate that which tests are to be required. And out of these 18 standards, which standards is applicable to your medical device? It depends upon type of the implant. It depends upon material of the implant. And this is what I was discussing, that in orthopedic industry, normally ISO 10993-15 for the skin sensitization is mandatory. ISO 10993-10, this is toxicology and teratogenicity test, but this is conducted in vitro. And the first one, ISO 10993-5 is conducted in vivo. So rabbits and guinea pigs are used for that, and this is important for the implant to be tested as per the standard and recording all the standards and all the requirements and all the results, so that you can set the safety. EN 1041, this is basically mandatory, and amendment has been added in 2013 that information of medical device should be supplied by the manufacturer. So whenever a product is being commercialized, there are certain set of information which is mandatory to be supplied by the manufacturer, because it is thought that the manufacturer is the ultimate authority who knows best about the product. A user doesn't know exactly that how, what process has been conducted, what has been incorporated, what temperature was when it was manufactured, what composition was when it was manufactured. So similarly, like being we are the human beings, Allah knows the best about us because He is the creator. Similarly, if we develop something, we should take responsibility and we should know our product. If we don't know something else and we are going to market a product, we are going to cause failure to the sale and causing the risk to the user. There is one standard, ISO 15223. This is medical device symbol to be used with medical device labels and labeling requirements. This is important because I am speaking in English, someone is speaking in Punjabi, someone is speaking in the Chinese and Germans. And to understand, to communicate, we need to have one common language. At the moment, what I am saying, you are understanding because I am speaking in English, you are understanding English. Similarly, in the medical devices, it is important what symbols should be used on the label. If I write the expiry date on one orthopedic implant and the other country doesn't have that standard to see the expiry date, they see some other symbol. So the a standard for these requirements have been established. So every medical device will be labeled with these specific symbols. So we cannot make our own symbol. We have to have the clock-like symbol for the manufacturing date, for the expiry date, and for the sterilization method. And whenever you see the label on the medical device, you will see certain set of symbols, and which is as per the set standards of the as per the product type. Because on the medicine, the label symbols are different, and on the medical devices, the label symbols are different. So storage conditions, the temperature of the storage condition, the atmospheric condition, like dry and sunlight, and the expiry, manufacturing date, and EU representative. If somebody is selling a product inside the Europe, and the product has been manufactured outside the Europe, the EU representative address is mandatory. Similarly, whenever we are using the products in orthopedic industry, you would be using some of the orthopedic implants which are provided as a sterilized. Sometimes these are sterilized by the hospital before you use, and sometimes these are supplied to you as a sterilized. For that, there is a specific standard which sets the requirement of the material, sterile barrier system and packaging system, because it is not possible that I pack something in the poly bag and put into the EQ sterilization, or I pack into the poly bag and put into the steam sterilization, the autoclave. So that is not a poly bag is not suitable for autoclave process. Similarly, for the ATO requirements, the ethylene oxide should penetrate and reach to the medical device inside the packaging. So if we follow these standard requirements, then we'll be using some specific material which is suitable certain type of sterilization. So in the next slide, I will be discussing that what types of sterilization are being used, and there are certain standards for each type of sterilization. And this is setting the requirement for the material, and this standard is setting the requirement for validation of the process. Whatever the process I am using in manufacturing of the orthopedic implant or any medical device, the process should be validated. It should be documented and it should be tested from the external lab, and particular requirement is there from some recognized lab. Similarly, if we are using the sterilized packed instruments or the orthopedic implant, it should be packed in the clean room. And clean room has certain requirements. If you look at your operation theater is a very good example of the clean room. In the same standard requirement of the clean room, the instrument should be packed before sterilization. And ethylene oxide, this is the most common process used for the sterilization worldwide, because it's usually in the world, the market is going towards the single use instruments. They use an instrument once and they discard it, and it is possible to individually pack each and every piece and to sterilize it through ethylene oxide. And the another standard is autoclave, which is the steam sterilization, very much common in our country, in all the developing countries. And still, this is one of the major process for sterilization throughout the world, because it's available in every hospital. Sterilization of for validation of this, there is also special standard. For radiation, you use this standard. And now there is a specific standard. The previous standard which I have discussed, these are the mandatory for all the orthopedic implants. But for individual implants, there are certain standards which are specific. Like for the screws, for the orthopedic implant screw, you need to have the screw which qualifies as per this standard, because the threads on the screws are the same, and these matching with the threads on the plate, so that in the operation theater, if you are screwing the plates, and if it is not matching, then it's going to create a mess for the patient, and at that time there is no replacement chance. Similarly, orthopedic nails have some specific standard. This standard was developed in 1985. And this standard was last reviewed and confirmed in 2016. So there's no change. You see how the things are developed. If you think once thoroughly and develop a thing which covers the future requirements and it is covering all the aspects, then it's long-term and durable. And if we see the implantable plates, then this is the standard for the plates. That what kind of strength these should have, what kind of holes it should have, what kind of material, we have already discussed. Standard for wires and pins, there is specific standard, ISO 5838. This is reviewed in 2013. After each 5 years, usually ISO standards are reviewed, and if there is a need to change or upgrade, these are given the new revision number. Otherwise, it is stated that this standard was last reviewed and confirmed in 2018. And now is the standards for prosthesis. Because this product, which was considered through the world up till now, the class 2B product. But after the introduction of medical device rules 2017, now it's going to be considered the class 3 device. And Indian standard 5393 was developed in 1969 for the sizes and the measurements of the prosthesis. This is another standard which sets the requirements of the joint replacements, specifically for the hip joint. And this is the standard for partial hip prosthesis requirements is mentioned on this standard. And this was reviewed in 2016. And there is an amendment in 2016 in this standard, which is partial and total hip replacements requirements are meeting in this. And this is also standard for partial and hip, which requires the determination of endurance properties.
that whenever a process is put into the human body, it remains in the body for the long time, and a person is walking and putting the whole body weight onto it, and the, it's moving inside the body. So endurance and load bearing and its life has to be passed through all these standards. And now the medical currently we were manufacturing and seeing the medical devices as per MDD, Medical Device Directive 93/42/EEC. But now the European Union had issued Medical Device Rule 2017, which is in the passing through the transitional phase. And in 2020, it will be fully implemented. And the European companies are converting and preparing themselves to convert to this new standard. And the problems here to comply these standards in Pakistan, particularly lack of quality control awareness, shortage of technical labor, because we are not having that much technical labor as much as is required for development of the orthopedic implants. Lack of accredited lab. This is one of the biggest issues. That if we develop some, like I was discussing with Dr. Fraser, that for the prosthesis, there are certain companies who want to market their product, but they are unable to get it tested from somewhere else in Pakistan. There is no currently accredited lab for the prosthesis testing. This is irony. And lack of technology use. Normally, the people are using the conventional machines, and there is less usage of the CNC machines. Development of technical drawing is one of the issue, because all the processes in implants and all the things, medical devices which we are going to develop, should be developed on paper first, then the practicals. Raw material and inventory controls are problem, because for the safe product, if I establish a standard that this material is going to be used in ISO as per ASTM or AISI standard 316L, which is commonly used in orthopedic implants, then it should be consistently supplied with that standard. It's not possible that once I got the shipment and we started using it, and next time it is not meeting that much requirements. So for the consistency of quality, consistency of the safety standard, we should have the proper inventory of the raw material and the control over the inventory. Shortage of technical consultants is one of the issue. Currently, if you develop a medical device and you want to market it, unfortunately in Pakistan, no notified body is working to issue you CE mark certificate. And that is an issue with the orthopedic implant industry, as well as only one company is CE marked for the orthopedic industry. Only one company currently. And whenever in 2019, the notified body will be losing its notified body status due to Brexit. Brexit is happening in Europe, but we are going to be affected with that. And high cost of standard certifications. This is important, because if you develop a product, it should pass through the safety door of the certification. Because once you pass through the standardization, then you can market the product, because it is considered to be safe whenever it has passed all the standard requirements. Challenges in MDR, Medical Device Directive. In Pakistan, Drug Regulatory Authority of Pakistan has established and it has issued the Medical Device Rules 2017, which are currently on hold in the court. And like it was also issued in 2015, MDR 2015, those were challenged in the Sindh High Court. Now the new one is challenged in the Lahore High Court. Still it's not implemented, and no local manufacturer has yet been registered with the DRAP. Certification process basically is ambiguous, because this organization is relatively new, and they have started working from, because they had very hands-on experience on the medicines, and the people working in the DRAP are the pharmaceutical background, and that's why they are considering more towards the pharmaceutical, but gradually it will be improving. I have already discussed that the regulator department itself new and relatively inexperienced, but the future opportunities are great opportunity as empty market, because if somebody is manufacturing a good quality medical device or orthopedic implant, the whole market is empty. because only one company is working and a large number of patients are there, a large number of doctors require the quality products. In increasing aging and increasing market demand, because the life expectancy is increasing the worldwide, and particularly in the later stages, the fractures are more common. Increasing accidents due to population in the traffic, this is our issue in Pakistan, because we are not well equipped to the standards, and not that much roads. And if you see how many cars are coming on the road on daily, and if we see how many people are getting the driving lessons, the difference between them clearly indicates that what's going to be happening in the next few months or in the next coming days. Similarly, definitely the accidents will increase. International market is increasing due to war zones, like in Afghanistan, like in Syria, like in Libya, like in Iraq. There are so many orthopedic issues, and there is a high demand of orthopedic implants. So any questions? From your side.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a round of applause to Mr. Chopra. If we can hold the questions on for the discussion section.
Okay.
Because we've got an international person coming on Skype.
Okay.
So we can do our talk and then we can go and take questions in this room. But let's give a round of applause for a very important talk.